वेलकम बैक। आई एम डॉक्टर अब्दुल कर, कंटिन्यूइंग विद लेक्चर सीरीज फॉर थर्ड फर्स्ट MBBS पार्ट टू। नाउ वी हैव कंप्लीटेड आर्टेरियल डिसऑर्डर्स, नाउ वी विल स्विच ओवर टू वीनस डिसऑर्डर्स। In venous disorders, we will discuss about the varicose vein in first lecture, and in second lecture, the treatment of varicose vein along with the treatment of venous ulcer, that is the complication of varicose vein. Now, we often discuss about the arterial disorders and their management, recent management. But venous disorder, they are equally important. Most of the time they are underrated. But nowadays we are dealing with various venous disorders, as it is equally important like arterial disorders. So if we know basic anatomy and physiology of venous system and venous return, then we can better understand what is venous hypertension, chronic venous hypertension, and what is the etiopathogenesis of varicose vein, how they develops, and management of varicose vein, and the complications, long-standing complication of varicose vein and venous ulcer. Coming to the surgical anatomy of venous system in leg, the leg is a tube with muscles surrounded by deep fascia and deep veins in the center. And superficial veins, they are superficial to the deep fascia, that is fascia lata, and deep to the superficial fascia, that is the saphenous fascia. The muscles, they are enclosed in inelastic fascia, and muscles are powerful with strong anti-gravity action. So the foot and the leg causes squeezing of blood, which helps for venous return. The blood is propelled towards the heart against the gravity. So these muscles, they should be powerful with strong anti-gravity action. Now coming to the long saphenous vein, that is great saphenous vein. It is the longest vein in the body. Maximum vein begins at the medial part of dorsal venous arch, that is the vein of Leonardo, passes in front of medial malleolus, straight up to the posterior medial aspect of knee, join there obliquely towards along the medial border of thigh up to saphenofemoral junction. Now this saphenofemoral junction, it is situated 1 inch below and lateral to the pubic tubercle, and it is joined with posterior medial vein, anterolateral vein or accessory saphenous vein, then posterior arch vein, anterior vein of leg. That is the picture showing the tributaries of long saphenous vein. In thigh, it receives posterior medial, anterolateral, anterior accessory saphenous. In fossa ovalis, the saphenous vein pierces the cribriform fascia to join the femoral vein. And there are other tributaries like superficial and deep external pudendal, superficial inferior epigastric, and superficial circumflex iliac laterally. Short saphenous vein begins at the lateral malleolus. It runs upward along the lateral border of tendo-Achilles, crosses into midline, and runs upward into popliteal fossa. It dips sharply to enter the popliteal vein at saphenopopliteal junction. Now, the saphenopopliteal junction is usually in the lower part of popliteal fossa, but the site varies in many person. It is not constant. Sometimes the saphenous vein is extended further cranially. That cranial extension of short saphenous vein called as Geikomini vein and it can join to the long saphenous vein. Deep veins, they lie in the center of tube among the powerful muscle. These veins accompany the named arteries like tibial, peroneal, popliteal, femoral. Now anterior tibial, posterior tibial and peroneal, they each having pair of veins, accompanying veins, at least six veins, and all these join to popliteal vein. From there, the vein goes into adductor canal as a femoral vein. Now these deep veins, they are liable for deep venous thrombosis. We will come to that later on. These veins, they are called as conduit veins. Now this is the picture showing great saphenous vein, long saphenous vein and short saphenous vein, which is entering in popliteal fossa. The great saphenous vein entering through the cribriform fascia into the femoral vein. Now coming to the important part of veins, that is perforating veins, which connects the superficial venous system to deep veins. They perforate deep fascia as well as intermuscular septum. The perforators can be direct small vessels, first connect muscle which connect to the deep veins, or indirect vessels, veins which are directly connecting to the deep veins. So direct and indirect perforator as shown in the diagram. Let us see the location of perforators. In thigh, it is at the hunters or adductor canal which connects great saphenous to femoral. It is called as Dodd's perforator. In adductor canal, there are perforators. So mid thigh perforators, they are called as Dodd's perforator. Then below knee, it is Boyd's perforator in relation with the gastrocnemius muscle. Then medially, ankle perforators, group of three perforators, upper medial, middle, just 10 cm above the tip of medial malleolus, lower one behind below the medial malleolus. So these medial ankle perforators, they are called as Clockett's perforator. Then again there are May or Kuster-Klusner's perforator around the ankle. So these are the perforator which are involved in the wall incompetency. So perforator incompetency is a major cause for development of varicose vein. So that is the various sites, and it is responsible for the development of varicose veins. Now how venous circulation occurs? It is from superficial to upward, and through perforator it is deep to, it goes to deep veins, and from there it will be propelled to, it goes to upward direction. So either it will go in upward direction through saphenofemoral junction or saphenopopliteal junction, and it will go through the perforators into deep veins, and from deep veins it will go to in upward direction. So at least 80% of blood will flow to the deeper vein, and some of 20% will go to through superficial vein directly into saphenofemoral and saphenopopliteal junction. If reversal of blood flow occurs, if the perforators are incompetent, then reversal of flow will occur as the deep venous pressure is more. So this reversal of flow will result into venous hypertension or venous insufficiency. Now how the blood flows upward in erect posture? So there is presence of wall greater saphenous vein having 12 to 20 and short saphenous vein having 6 to 12 walls, unidirectional wall. So blood will not flow in reverse direction. The relatively thicker muscular coat of superficial veins of lower limb, and it is also called as capacitance vessels because nearly 60% blood is present in venous system. Deep veins, they are surrounded by powerful anti-gravity muscles with strong contraction, so that will push the blood upward towards heart against the gravity. Now this tibial, peroneal, femoral veins, they are called as veins of conduit. Now this soleus muscle is having venous spaces which are communicating with the superficial veins to deep veins. The contraction of this soleus muscle, cup muscles, will push the blood in deep veins. So these are called as peripheral heart. Again, the foot vessel, foot veins, they will contract and push the blood upward during walking. So these foot pump and cup pump, they will push the blood upwards. They will help for the venous return. So blood is pushed from superficial vein to deep vein during relaxation of these muscles. So in erect position, the veins, foot veins, having pressure up to 100 millimeter of mercury because of gravity. So the blood is pushed against the gravity for venous return. So the soleus muscle contains venous sinuses, that is called as peripheral heart. Similarly, foot acts as a pump to propel the blood. Normal venous pressure is 5 to 10 millimeter of mercury. In foot vein, it is 10, and it will reduce up to the inferior vena cava to 5 millimeter. The walking pressure in the soleus sinuses, soleus vein, it is 200 to 300 millimeter of mercury. And normally the arterial end pressure is in the arterioles is 32 millimeter. At venular end, it is 12 millimeter of mercury. So that is the pressure gradient which allows for the blood circulation. So superficial veins dress 10 to 20%, deep veins at least 80-90%. Now coming to the varicose veins, that is the common entity we get in surgical practice. So what are these varicose veins? These are permanently dilated, tortuous, elongated superficial veins of leg. Or there can be a segment of vein with valvular incompetence leading to dilatation, tortuosity and elongation due to reversal of blood flow. So veins which are more than 3 mm size, they are called as varicose veins. Less than 3 mm, 1 to 3 mm, they are called as reticular veins. If it is less than 1 mm, we call it as a thread veins. Now there are other sites where you can get varicosities. Lower limb, great saphenous vein varicosity, short saphenous vein varicosity, or saphenofemoral junction varices at the saphenofemoral junction, or you can get varices at the saphenopopliteal junction. Then esophageal varices in portal hypertension, varicosal in spermatic cord veins, hemorrhoidal veins also, they are dilated varicose veins. So these are the other sites where you can get varicose vein. So commonly we see these external varicosities in leg and thigh, lower extremity. Now why this varicose vein develops? So some morphological factors, like we are having erect posture. So quadruplets don't get varicose veins or varicosity. So that is said to be the penalty of our erect posture, where the vein needs to drain against the gravity. Secondly, the superficial veins have poor support. They are embedded in loose areolar subcutaneous tissue. So the type of varicosities, there are primary varicosities due to primary cause, or secondary varicosities due to secondary cause, and congenital varicosities, congenital weakness of wall or weakness in the wall due to any congenital hereditary condition. So primary varicose vein develops due to defect in walls and perforators. So wall of perforator becomes incompetent. So that is thought to be the major cause. So defect at the saphenofemoral junction causing reflux of blood in great saphenous vein. Defect in saphenopopliteal junction that is causing reflux in small saphenous vein developing into small saphenous vein varicosities. Then nowadays more commonly thought that it is the changes in the wall of the superficial veins. So these changes in the form of smooth muscle weakness due to myoepithelial dysfunction, due to defective connective tissue disorder, then collagen deposits, again that is causing reduced elastin level in the wall and increased matrix metalloproteinase, then cellular infiltrate of inflammatory cells, stretching of deep fascia. So these are the causes, these are the factors which are responsible for the primary varicose veins. And again, some hereditary causes, familial causes can be there where this varicosity starts at early age. Secondary varicose vein develops due to mechanical obstruction in the returning veins. For example, pregnancy due to pressure of gravid uterus on pelvic vein. And in pregnancy, there are hormonal changes, increased progesterone that is causing dilatation and relaxation of veins, which are predisposing to development of secondary varicose vein. Then tumors in the pelvis are retroperitoneal tumors, fibroid uterus, cyst, CA cervix, ovary, sigmoid, rectal carcinomas, retroperitoneal mass or lymph nodes or fibrosis. All this mechanically compressing the pelvic vein, and that can lead to back pressure and destruction of wall, pressure on wall, and it can lead to predispose to development of varicose veins. Then deep venous thrombosis, obstruction in the deep veins due to thrombosis will cause back pressure and wall destruction. Destruction of perforator walls resulting into reversal of flow and development of varicose vein. Effect of hormones, increased progesterone leading to relaxation of veins and dilatation. Other predisposing factors like prolonged standing still resulting into stasis, pressure on the wall leading to weakness of wall. Now the person engaged in prolonged standing occupation like guards, teacher or drivers, they can develop this varicose veins. So prolonged standing due to occupation, person needs to stand for a prolonged period, that can predispose to development of varicose veins. Then obesity, hypertension, the presence of fat in subcutaneous layer weakens the support. Then again pregnancy, first trimester mechanical obstruction by intrapelvic uterus, third trimester pressure by pregnant uterus, and then effect of hormones that is the progesterone. These are the predisposing factor for the development of varicose vein. Again, in old age, wall weakness, poor muscular support, they are predisposing to development of varicocities as the age becomes old. In athletes, forceful muscular contraction can cause back pressure, thus distracting the perforators causing varicose vein. Now, this perforator and communicating veins, they are in direct opposition. So, direct pressure can be there on the perforators leading to the destruction. So, in athletes, you can get varicose veins due to back pressure. Clinically, with the, as the age advances, the chances of or incidence of varicose vein increases. In females, it is 10 times common. Height, ethnicity may be the factor because of long column of blood against the gravity. Occupation like policemen, guards, who has to stand for a long period. There can be family history, familial tendency can be there, genetic factors can be there. Symptoms directly proportional to the degree of varicosities. So varicosities can be mild, asymptomatic, or severe with severe symptoms. So common symptoms like tired and aching sensation in leg due to dilated veins. Then muscular cramps, especially after retiring, or night cramps, venous cramps. They are due to hypoxia of veins, vasa vasorum, stretching of veins. Sharp pain can occur in a grossly dilated vein. Then again, bursting pain while walking or prolonged standing results due to gross varicosities. Mostly they are associated with deep vein obstruction like deep vein thrombosis. So that can give rise to bursting pain during walking or prolonged standing. So pain is a major factor from dull aching, heavy, tired heaviness in the leg to bursting pain. So depending on the severity of or degree of varicosities. So examination should be done in standing position and also in lying down position to empty the vein. So in standing position, you will find the single varix at saponofemoral junction, that is called as saponavarix. So you can feel the cuff impulse or thrill at the saponofemoral junction due to reflux. So great saponus vein varicosities, they are usually situated on medially. Short saponus veins varicosities, they are mostly seen on lateral part of the leg. Great saponus vein varicosities, they are mostly present on medial side, and also they can extend in the thigh. Then early symptoms, that is a ankle flare, that is the early symptom. Then there can be ankle edema around the joint. Then itching, eczema, pigmentation can be there due to hemosiderosis, the leaking of RBCs and breakdown of hemoglobin in the tissue that causes pigmentation and hemosiderosis. The lipodermosclerosis, that is the thickening of skin and subcutaneous tissue due to infiltration, due to cellulitis, lymphangitis, if it becomes a chronic. So skin becomes thickened, skin and subcutaneous tissue become thickened with brown pigmentation, that is called as browning induration. So that condition is known as lipodermosclerosis. And this lipodermosclerosis also causes fibrosis at the ankle, but the cuff region remains the same. So that gives appearance like inverted champagne bottle. The lipodermosclerosis, and then venous ulceration in the lower part of our leg and around the ankle. Then atrophic blanch, that is the white pigmented atrophic patches of skin surrounded by pigmentation and dilated capillaries. So that is called as atrophic blanch. So these changes, lipodermosclerosis, ulcer, venous ulcer, atrophic blanch, they suggest the advanced disease or chronic disease due to varicose veins. Now, while examining the varicose vein, we have to assess the severity of the varicose veins, then saponofemoral and saponopopliteal incompetence, then perforator incompetence, and presence of DVT. We have to rule out the DVT. These are the essential things on examination. So various tests, they are designed for during the examination of varicose veins. So Brody tunneling burr test, it is for testing the competency of saponofemoral wall. The tourniquet is applied below the saponofemoral junction after emptying the veins by raising the leg. And patient is asked to stand and walk, and then the tourniquet is released. You can see the varicose, there is a filling of vein, a saponous vein from above, that is due to saponofemoral reflux. Now in modified Brody tunneling burr test, we don't release the tourniquet, but we ask the patient to walk after emptying the veins. You will see that there is a reversal of flow at the saponofemoral junction due to incompetency, and there can be rapid filling of veins from below. So that indicates the perforator competency. So modified Brody tunneling burr test helps us to determine the saponofemoral wall incompetency, saponofemoral reflux, and the perforator's incompetency, whether the perforator are incompetent. Now this is the three tourniquet test to determine the perforator incompetency. So after raising the leg, veins are emptied, then tourniquets, they are applied below the saponofemoral junction, and at the hunter canal above the knee, and one below the knee and one near the ankle. We can use three or four tourniquets, and the tourniquets, they are released from below one by one. So you can know the level of perforator, which group of perforator they are incompetent. So they will start filling, or some group is group of vein, varicose vein, isolated veins they are filling. So that will determine the site of perforation, perforator of the varicose veins. In Pratt's test, the Ismar's bandage is applied from below upward, followed by tourniquet at saponofemoral junction. The bandage is released and we can see the blowout at the site of perforator. So this is done to know the position of incompetent leg perforators. In Perthes test, we wrap the elastic bandage from below upward and patient is asked to walk and exercise. Patient will feel severe cramps and pain in the calf, which signifies the presence of DVT. So that is to know the patency of deep veins. And in modified Perthes, instead of elastic bandage, we use a tourniquet below the saponofemoral junction. Without emptying the veins, patient is asked to walk and exercise, so he will feel bursting pain, severe pain, if the DVT is present. So Perthes test, it is done to rule out the DVT and competency of communicating veins. Now in Shorts test, we tap the varicosity in lower part of the leg, and you can feel the thrill near the saponofemoral junction or at the saponofemoral junction. That is due to dilated column of blood in the dilated vein. Morris's cuff impulse, To know the incompetence saphenofemoral junction, you can feel the cuff impulse at saphenofemoral junction in case of saphenovarix. Fagan's method is done to locate the perforator. So if the patient is standing and he is asked to stand, you can see the blowouts at the site of incompetent perforator. Then the patient is asked to lie down, and after raising the leg, you can see the crescentic defects at the site of perforator. So we can mark the perforators by this Fagan's method. So that is to locate the perforators. Now, varicose veins, they run a chronic course. As there is a venous insufficiency and chronic, it results into chronic venous hypertension, resulting into incompetency of wall. Since it runs a chronic course, it develops into complications. So these complications can occur if there are varicose veins, long-standing varicose veins, months together or years together. The common complication, if there is a trauma or there is a bursting of vein, it can cause torrential hemorrhage as the veins, they are under pressure, the venous hypertension, the hemorrhage is torrential. Then because of stasis, there can be thromboflebitis. In long standing varicosity, there can be calcification of wall, and this thromboflebitis can extend through the perforators, resulting into deep vein thrombosis. Now these varicose veins, they can occur due to deep vein thrombosis, or in rare cases they can cause deep venous thrombosis in a reverse way. The pigmentation occurs due to extravasation of RBCs from the thinned out walls. So brown black pigmentation due to release of hemosiderin, which is the breakdown product of hemoglobin. So pigmentation occurs, you can see the pigmentation in lower part of leg, around ankle, in chronic cases. So again this pigmentation, then there is a eczema, chronic itching, chronic dermatitis, and ultimately the thickening of skin and subcutaneous tissue that results into browny induration, that is condition known as the lipoderma sclerosis. Now these venous ulcers, they are called as gravitational ulcers, that can develop due to chronic venous hypertension. Again, this chronic ulcer can get turned into malignant ulcers, squamous cell ulcer, that is called as Marjolin ulcer, due to chronic breakdown of ulcer and fibrosis. Then chronic fibrosis of soft tissue around the ankle results into restricted movement of ankle joint and causing the ankylosis. Then there is a shortening of tendo-Achilles, causing telepathy coronavirus deformity. Patient is walking on the tip of toes, that is called as tiptoe deformities. There is a thickening of tibia due to periosteitis. This periosteitis again causes non-healing of venous ulcer. So these are the complications which can occur in long-standing varicose veins. So that's why it requires to be treated earlier to prevent the complication. Now varicose veins, they are diagnosed clinically easily, and they can be assessed with different tourniquet test, different tests. The other investigations, they are mainly required to know the extent of varicosities, whether localized or whether they are extending, the competency of perforators, competency of saphenofemorals, popliteal saphenopopliteal junction, whether there is a reflux flow, and presence of DVT, or whether it is a post DVT syndrome. So most important and useful investigation, that is a venous Doppler or duplex scan, these are the useful investigation. So color Doppler, we are routinely doing color Doppler, venous Doppler, that will rule out the DVT, presence of thrombosis, deep vein thrombosis. Perforators, we can mark the perforator, status of perforator, reversal of flow through the perforators, that becomes a biphasic flow. Again, duplex scan, we can know the anatomy and functional study of the venous blood flow. So Mickey Mouse sign is described at the junction of saphenofemoral region. So that is due to dilated veins, the dilated saphenous vein medially, then femoral vein in between, and laterally femoral artery. So this gives the appearance of Mickey Mouse. So that is called a Mickey Mouse sign, which confirms the presence of dilated saphenous vein. X-ray leg is done to rule out the periostitis, thickening of tibia. USG abdomen to rule out any abdominal pathology, tumor, retroperitoneal compression, or iliac vein thrombosis. MR venography is relatively non-invasive to know the DVT or pelvic vein thrombosis. Venous hemodynamic mapping is necessary before surgery, so you can plan the management accordingly. Ambulatory venous pressure, the venous pressure in standing in foot vein, that is up to 100 millimeter. If patient is asked to ask for exercise, then it drops. So this ambulatory pressure is measured by introducing a transducer in foot vein, dorsal foot vein, and patient is asked to exercise, tiptoe exercise or hopping exercise, and the pressure is measured. If it is more than 80 millimeter of mercury, then that is suggestive of that patient can develop varicose ulcer. So 80 millimeter and above ambulatory venous pressure is suggestive of preceding development of venous ulcer. Then venography, that is invasive. It can be done ascending by applying tourniquet at ankle and injecting dye through the foot vein, or the dye can be injected in the femoral vein. From above, so that is to rule out the deep vein thrombosis. Since it is invasive, we are not using this venography techniques. So that is replaced by this venous Doppler and duplex scan. So we can assess the degree of varicosity, incompetent perforator, presence of DVT. Because if the DVT is present, then it is contraindicated for treatment of varicose veins. So DVT is absolute contraindication for any surgical treatment. So this investigation will help us to assess the severity of varicose veins, any complications, and accordingly we can plan the treatment. So that is all for varicose vein. Now in this part we have studied the clinical aspect, pathophysiology, and how to assess the varicose veins. In next lecture we will continue with the treatment of varicose vein in detail and treatment of venous ulcer, that is the complication of long standing venous varicose vein. Thank you for your patient listening. Thank you again.